This is a nice question. It's a very big question. But I'm very fascinated by since some time, but more and more, not less and less, is this idea that the sun actually has a nature, so it's born and it dies. And when I looked for, so without being a physicist, of course, when I tried to find how it is that a sun can be born, what I found is that there is, so a sun is always giving birth to a galaxy, and it forms from the material, the cosmic dust, they call it, of other suns which have died, on galaxies which have died, which somehow go through space. And when there is such a coincidence that particular particles or whatever they would be, not their dust, so they're not molecules, they're not particles, they're traces or something like this. When they meet in a very unlikely situation, they begin to synthesize. And this beginning of the synthesizing attracts more dust, and this is how a sun is being born. Yeah, so this I find very, very extraordinary. Also because it means that light, the most elusive that we have, is the heaviest. So there is this, it's odd to call it a continuity between mass and light, but it is something of that kind. No? And then when you really, or when I started to contemplate this, it goes very fast because it means that in a certain sense, then the suns are the mediators which give space. No? In the sense that we measure distances in the cosmic scale through duration to a Big Bang, so through time. And the units of measurement of this distance is the speed of light. So we are living in a present of contemporaneity of the universe with itself, but only in a tiny little nook of it, so to say. And also it's not properly called a space because there is no homogeneity. So it's not like a nook in a house where you have a corner and then the rest of the body, but it's somehow playing on scales which are incommensurate or not immediately commensurate to one another. And this I find quite breathtaking, what it implies, what one can see in it. And the formulation that I am very fond of currently is to say or to think what it would mean to assume that space is always abducted from time. So what we call space, a measurement which is no longer a measurement in time, but in a way a tempering of time, so that that time at this light speed gets a certain presence or a duration. And then the next question is, so this abduction, no? Abduction is a term which I always liked from logics, from Charles Peirce. He was a 19th century mathematician, actually, and a metaphysician. And he tried to propose a third way of making inferences, which wouldn't be deductive or inductive, but abductive. And it had something to do with, he called it also a creative kind of reasoning. But it is strictly reasoning, but it always means you depart from what doesn't have a ground. No, so in a way, what has no support. And by departing from what has no support, it can gain a presence such that it can become a statement. Yeah, so ideas like this, I'm very fascinated by, because the logical side of abduction is one side, but another side that is related to it is that if the sun is this in a way the embodiment of time, so massive time, no? So time which doesn't just pass but which ages, like we speak of the universe has an age, every galaxy has an age. What we call data, strictly, when we say that the sciences are dating their objects. For example, when certain life forms appeared on Earth, or how old a certain certain planet is or whatever. This is a question of an age, but it's an age which is objective and natural. So and there is a way to relate to time which we have absolutely unexplored so far. So the our notions of either stories or history, neither of them captures it. So there is an aging involved, which is material, and it is at the same time literally light, so it's radiating. And this means the notion of weight or of gravity, which is associated with mass, and also with the Big Bang, there must be a kind of a counterforce to it. And this, I think, is what Simone Weil, in her book Grace and Gravity, began to explore. No? And I think this is related to your interest in life, insofar as the feeling of being alive has a lot to do with going counter gravity, no? So countering gravity, because it's the only way when things that we think or we do can have weight. And only if it has weight, it's first of all not caused by us, not entirely, no? But it's somehow more tempered or kept in play, or it's a different way of relating to it. And it also, for her, it meant that there is an acceptance of a metaphysics of something spiritual, but a metaphysics in the sense of not of a theology, but of a natural philosophy. So for her, grace being a condition, well, being an act which is unconditional. So that's a term, I think, which becomes very important when we try to think about this question of life, or what it is to be alive, or how to live in such a nature, in such a universal nature, to come to terms somehow with a manner of acting which is unconditional, but it's acting nevertheless. And this idea of acting, there is one story about the abduction of space which I then found, and it concerns actually the myth of Europe as a place, because Europe is not properly a continent, no? So this is interesting in itself. It's not properly a continent, and it's also not a territory. And this myth, which is told in many versions, but there is one version which I like especially, and it was told by a grammarian, one of the first grammarians, when writing didn't have grammars yet. So this is also something very interesting to think about. You know, how did grammars come into how is one thinking when one invents grammar? And this guy, he was called Moschos. He is one of the first poets at the same time who was writing in the figure of what is called an ekphrasis. And an ekphrasis literally means something that steps out of its phrases. So it's making a statement such that something can leave it. It's an ekphrasis. So that's philologically, but from its meaning, it was meant a way of writing that would evoke in the reader or in the listener a vivid picture inside his own inner eye. So not just a picture, not a representation, but a vivid one. And he added something very important to this myth of Europe, which in the classical version is a princess on the Asian continent. And so the story goes that she had a dream where two women were fighting over her. So one was her mother, who wanted her to continue the princess and to continue the lineage and everything that goes with it. And the other one was not native to anywhere at all. It was an immaterial mother. So this also is such an interesting idea, no? An immaterial mother. Usually we have the figure of the feminine and with the receptive, with the mass, with material, with the matrix, and we have the form and the semen. So these distinctions are very clear, but it collapses in this story. So there are these two women. They are fighting over her. She wakes up. She's very puzzled. She goes to play with her friends, and she picks flowers. And then Zeus had fallen in love with her. So he came in the form of a bull, and seduced her to trust him. And then she climbs his back, and he goes across the sea to Crete, I think, I'm not sure. And what Moschus adds to this story is that Europa had a basket while she was being abducted by Zeus and brought to a foreign place. And in this basket, there lies her destiny. And it's asleep. Her destiny is asleep for the duration of the abduction. And this has something to do with this ekphrasy. So to relate to a kind of a fate or a destiny or a story that would already be conditioned and conclusive, but to give it a break, but not in order to do away with it, and also not in order to determine it anew, but just to carry it along. And there is a kind of a break in scale involved, which for me captures best this idea of space being abducted from time. It has something to do with stepping next to oneself. And then, of course, it goes further because Europe is called Europe because the land where she was brought to when she was being abducted was going to take her name. But it wouldn't be the name from where she comes from. No? It would be the name from that land which was evoked or initiated or started with her having been abducted and brought there into a foreign place, and this foreignness was at the same time her innermost identity, we could perhaps say. So I'm not sure about any of these interpretations, but as a constellation of idea, together with this coincidence of mass and light, of the most elusive and the least elusive at one and the same time, this I find super, super interesting to think about. Yeah, and then of course the question would be what or how to think of a geometry if space is abducted. So if space doesn't cover or kind of duplicate, no, or map something which is given but comes into being through such an abduction. So how then what then is geometry doing? And then there is a notion of instrumentality, which is very interesting, because it's an instrumentality which is somehow decoupled from a telos or from a linear movement. So it's an instrumentality which would be more in the sense of a harmonics, not as a harmony, but as having the consonances and the dissonances and the kind of a deep integration or something like that, which is unconditional, no? So we can't measure how deep it is. So it's a kind of another vector that would complement or perhaps counter this axis of the age of the universe, this enormous idea that the universe has an age. This was interesting when I tried to prepare to sort my ideas a bit in relation to your question. Observation is not a term that I would use really a lot, but it can be. So what I started out from is to look at the term itself, observation, and it has a very interesting association with keeping something safe. An observation. So it comes from servare, which is to watch over, but also to keep something safe. And then op, of course, in front of. I would then like to think of observation in a similar manner like a Europa with this basket. Yeah. So how could one keep something safe of which one doesn't know what it is? It existentially involves oneself and one cannot control it. Or one can only keep it safe if one does not try to control it somehow. And then from this, I think there is a quite concrete shift that would happen. So observation wouldn't be about perspectives. So it wouldn't be about tracing developments and processes and interrelations, but rather the observation would be not so much centered on the object under observation. This should be let alone. That's how one can keep it safe. But the fabrication of an optics that allows one to let it be. Yeah. So an optics which doesn't try to get a true picture of things, but an optics which creates a kind of an ideation, a kind of a speculation, which wants to be real in the sense that it lets this thing that one wants to observe, or this object, or that point of interest, let's say, lets it be. So that doesn't obsess with it, but lets it live in parallel to this. And such an observation then would, how I think of it, so there is a there is a story which has very much impressed me when I was much younger. I was I knew somebody who had studied a very special kind of little apes. He was a biologist. So they studied the behavior of animals. And the thing that is so interesting there is that in order to study the behavior of animals, you need to have a hypothesis about these animals. Because if you study them, you need to set up a kind of a model in terms of which you can calibrate a certain thesis and see whether it actually adequately describes this behavior. And the most drastic instance where I understood what this meant is I remember it was in 2009, not very long, when I came across a newspaper article, which in I think it was the Spiegel or FAZ, I'm not sure. It was quite prominent, and it was a very odd topic. It said that chimpanzees can laugh. And then when I read the article, it was clear that this was such a kind of an optics at stake, because for a very long time, chimpanzees counted as extremely aggressive animals, which somehow behaved inconclusive. So there were always this demonstration of aggression through a certain kind of face they made. But then the actions that followed wouldn't confirm the aggression. So this was very puzzling. And then there were some scientists, and they just turned the hypothesis and said, well, maybe they are laughing. Yeah, because how would we recognize in an animal face whether they are laughing? It's not something, so we see these faces all the time, but how could we possibly recognize that? And then the other question is, how can you validate that, of course? But this, I didn't follow it much further. What was interesting is that apparently this change in optics, it's not a change in perspective, because it changes everything that you can see. No? It changes how you link up the data points into a kind of a confirmation theory. So it's an optics about these animals, and it made much more sense. And it is an observation which opens up interest. No, so then the observation doesn't confirm what you expect, but it opens up because it has such a tail. Now, if chimpanzees can laugh, I mean, laughing is something super abstract. So the entailments of that are enormous, what that means. So there is something very mechanical about it, but that's not enough to explain laughter. And then even a culture of humor, no, apparently. So this is what I would associate with observation in relation to an optics under such ideas. And then that would mean that it's a lot about model building, but not models that would duplicate or represent something, but models that allow us to see what we don't expect to find, in a way. And interestingly, so this was another anecdote, so this is all a bit loose, but I hope to make constellation of motifs, maybe. Another thing that I realized while preparing one of my lectures in the last semester was that, we so casually say somebody is a star, so a model in film or in movies or in architecture, they are stars. And then there is this kind of impulse. So if one is coming from cultural studies, no one has this impulse to not really go with the stars, but to find the side phenomena and the unmapped things and so on. But there is something very profound about this, namely that if we say models, which we want to take as a kind of a guidance in this optics sense, if we say, okay, a model in the sense of a star represents or embodies something that oneself would aspire to, or at least would find somehow precious and interesting. So then by calling it a star, one really kills one kills the referent of this, because nothing is more predictable than the star, no? From our points of view. So the star is entirely cyclical and steady and always. So you can pinpoint it. Whereas in fact, it's much more, so people that come to be called stars, they're much more like meteors. They come, no, meteors are these crazy bodies that travel through galaxies and times. So they literally bear traces, they grew of their age through different and probably also incommensurate timescales. So they're singular and they're unique and they're a force. A meteor is a force. And it appears and it is there. And what it brings along changes what one has thought about the ordinary. So the people whom we call stars, they are much more meteors, not stars. So by making it a habit to call them stars, we kill them, no? We close them up. So now it's not about these people, but it's about observations of which we always casually demand that they close a case. So we want to do observations in order to conclude a thesis, to make a statement of it. And if we would relate such models, no, which we could call stars if you want, but it's more interesting to say, how can we find or fabricate a model which would be like a meteor? No, in a way absurd, but not so absurd that it can't be substantiated. So to look for things which are not very likely, but which are also not which can be substantiated with observations, no, which help to explain things in a way that is not decided, no, but it can be convincing, or it can be suggestive, or it can be further inspiring. And then what I also think, but there I don't know where to bring this really, but it must, I think this kind of optics, of thinking about optics, must have something to do with our, or must perhaps prove useful in how we deal with machine learning and big data. Because what we do there is spectral forms of analysis, no? And in a spectrum, there is always, so ultimately all material is spectral. If we say that mass is the radiation from the sun, and then depending on the frequency, spectra, there's the same radiation can be, well, many things at the same time. That's why I call the scales incommensurate. So then this optics would be, if we say that the optics which gave us the idea of spectra, this was Newton. So this was the classical physics where light and matter were not understood to be of a continuity. And there, basically, things are composed through colors in the Newtonian optics. And the colors can neutralize each other. That's why you can have the white light with the prism. And then the question would be, if this optics, which tries to get models for making observations in a way that lets us leave alone the object, now keep it safe by leaving it alone. But this only works through knowing how to relate to it, so to becoming familiar with it, but in an exterior kind of way, not through identifying it, but from kind of cohabiting with it, learning about its behaviors enough that one must not be so scared. Yeah. Then these absurdities, which should be substantiated through an observation, I think one of the most plausible pictures for me is the many, many images. So that when in Newton's optics, everything is made of colors, now things would be made of images. But images which are not images in the materiality. So like pixels, no? They don't give, they're never full, they're scattered. There's a big mass of scattered images, and there is something, this is what I would then what I wanted to say with regard to chance. So it's a kind of an epiphany that comes from such an optic. So it's an optic really which doesn't capture but which wants to set free without controlling it. There is one saying that a friend of mine who is a performance artist, Heinrich Lüber, he always had, when we were, this is, yeah, it's a long time ago, but we were, when I was living in Basel, we were working together, and he always had this saying, which said, everything that ever happened to me was completely unlikely or improbable. I'm not sure actually which word he used. But this captures so well why I am a bit struggling with the individuality here, because the things of which we would say they happened to us in our lives, they cannot be things which were to be expected. No? So the things which were to be expected, it's hard to pay notice to those things. But then that also means that the things which happen to oneself, they are somehow not, I don't feel they're adequate, they can be adequately addressed on such an individual scale. Because if one would bring them to an individual scale, one is very quickly with ideas of not being specifically talented or gifted or somehow taken out of a norm and equipped by other means and so on. So then there is a sender, let's say, of this chance immediately present. So I would rather keep the so this individuality of an answer, well, to let it be, let's say, see what comes out of it, and rather speak about the chance in relation to a quality which I would call impersonal. So because I think this is what this, so this unlikeliness that happens to us, no? So because there is this very, very strange sense of being personally addressed by chance. Otherwise, we wouldn't call it chance. We wouldn't even notice. We wouldn't know. We wouldn't be attentive to it. So it's a way of how we are personally addressed by it, but at the same time, it cannot be us as persons. So it's almost like a, so the normality of my person needs to be disrespected, let's say, but touched to such an extent that I can still relate to it, even so I cannot orient myself in it. And there is a funny game of putting this question of night and day and knowledge or not knowledge in a kind of an instrument by saying, by bringing in this factor of liking, no? Because it's complicated. Something that happens to me, when it happens, in most cases, I don't know if I like it. So that's exactly why I call it, it's happening. So I don't know what to do with it or what it affects or what it produces. So to bring in this aspect of like and likening or liking as well into the question of knowledge or of knowing or not knowing, of day or night. So we usually, or it's almost quite a cliche, you know, to say I know that I don't know. So, but it's a very deep, it can be a very deep saying, but how to get to the depth of it, no? And then I think with such a, so in the sense of crafting an optics for it, it's interesting to multiply it and to vary it. So to say I like that I know, or I like that I don't know. And then to have this as a kind of an optics with regards to things that happen to me. Because of course there are things that happen to me which I like, but I don't like that I like it. Yeah, and other things which I don't like, but I like that I don't like it, and so on. So to bring it into such a kind of a, I don't know, like a calibration perhaps. And then chance becomes it's no longer important to identify or to relate to this chance event that is happening through kind of making a consequential loop, not to the sender of it or its meaning or its reason or anything like that. But it's simply there, no? It's like the sunlight. So chance then is simply there. We don't need to think or relate to it in terms of causality, but in terms of how can I keep it safe? How can I temper it? How can I hold on to it without appropriating it? Because then, of course, it wouldn't be a chance event anymore and it would lose its preciousness. So what seems like a completely improbable event, I mean, in the formulation of Heinrich, it still is, it's kind of retrospective. Yeah. So it's like when we draw a Bilanz ziehen, no? when we draw an account of what has happened, or when we try to tell our story or so, that we would say such a thing. But how could it be life, a way of relating to this? And this, I think, There, the term of the of an epiphany is so interesting. So an epiphany literally means a striking appearance. So it's an appearance which is radiating, no? Which is I would call this which is incandescent. So it is of a light character. It is radiating, but it's also of a mass. So it's the other term of it is a manifestation of something, or a screening, a displaying, a shining force. But this shining force is now modulated through this optics. So it's not an immediate phenomenon. No, it's a modulated phenomenon which shows itself in the way that I relate to it. If I ask myself, do I like that it appears like that or not? and play this game. It's a kind of an epiphany, so something which shines forth, but it is it's like a modulation of its unconditionality. So to bring it back to the relation of Simone Weil, when she says grace is a natural force, just like gravity, a natural force. So I don't need to ask from whom am I receiving a gift, or to whom do I need to be thankful, but it's just there. It's there like the wind is there, or like gravity is there. So grace is just there, but that means it's impersonal. My way to relate to it is impersonal, but I relate to it actively by saying an epiphany is an appearance which is unconditional in that sense. So it's not just a phenomenon. It's not just an impression. It's also not really an image. It has much more to do with a screen, no? Not the pictures that appear in front of the screen, but a kind of a screen. Perhaps. Yeah, and then this is an image for me as well to think about, and if space is always abducted, so then space would initially always be an epiphany. And then when it realizes its own name, so it wouldn't be then about naming phenomena or things. It would be about unnaming. So the epiphany must unname itself to become entirely impersonal, because only if it becomes impersonal, otherwise it's my impression or it's my sensibility or my affect. But if it has something to do with this abduction of space, then it needs to neutralize me completely out of it, what it is. So it needs to become an object. No? It needs to acquire a kind of a neutrality. And this, I think, is interesting. What is complicated then is to ask whether for such an understanding of space, it's as if it's like chicken or egg. So then it would be as if an optics in such an alienating manner, so an impersonal, an optics which wants to make things impersonal, in order to give them the chance to become objects or to become objective, or so to become intersubjectively recognizable or to fit in, to be able to be joined together with other things. And I think it's good that the two are not in a, if one were the cause of the other, it would be a mannerism. No, it wouldn't be substantial, but they must be, yeah, somehow the same thing. without like the light as mass and the light as the immaterial. They're the same thing, but they're not. And the fact that they're not just means, it's larger than what we can reason analytically. Having developed a line with the sun and space as being abducted, to speak of a living space would exactly kill it all. So I wouldn't, but to put it in another way, perhaps, what I sympathize with a lot, because I think you're looking for that, is a notion of living space which wouldn't be territory, which wouldn't be a life world specific for. What we usually call territory. So a living space which wouldn't be territory. I don't think this is possible. So I think that's what keeps it in, what keeps life and space then different. I would say is precisely that a space needs to be impersonal, no? and generic if you want. an abstract in it. So in principle, space is no longer space, it becomes room, or it becomes territory, or it becomes place. It becomes any of these terms or plot. As soon as something individual or specific is introduced in it. And that's why I would say space is never pure. No? So there, it's not the case that there is any space. That would be just the space. But that perhaps then leads to a way of how I would perhaps frame this Lebensraum, this living space, to say that there is space in every room. So, you know, in a way to turn it around, not there are rooms in a space, but to say there is space in every room or in every site or in every place. So then, but it's a very abstract idea, because it would mean that a containment that is finite, no, a space is that which facilitates containment, whereas room would be contained. But then it would precisely be the bounds of such a containment that would allow us to tunnel or to access or to have a relation to space. And then that quality of breaking through the containment, like this Renaissance painting where you stick your head out. So this is very much related to a sense of being alive, let's say. So this would radically, in a way, distance the notion of Lebensraum from ideas of comfort, or where the object would be to find comfort. So it would almost turn in its opposite. And spaces that I find attractive, I think, are, maybe then there is even a continuity between rooms and things. So there are things where this quality of space is somehow there. So things which manifest the promise of an opening. And I think this is important, that this opening is not in time. So it can only be an opening because it is time that has been tempered or kept safe or put to the side or somehow been stolen from time. Temporality that has been stolen from time. So this has the possibility of an opening. In time, if there were not such embodiment of time, of the aging of time, everything would be a generic mass. There wouldn't be anything. So, but that's why, that's also why I think it's completely unproductive to speak of a space-time continuum and things like that. Of course, one can make craft optics like this, but what you see is always only to reconfirm kind of a duration that a historical view gives us of things. And then with things, what is interesting is that it's relation to reality, of course. And then the reality, I don't know whether other languages have it in the same way, but I think it's very specific that the German language calls reality eine Wirklichkeit. So it has das Werken, so the doing, not only the working, actually, inside of it. So it is an inherently dynamic view. And perhaps if we link a thing as being graspable, so that means it's not dynamic. A thing is somehow stated, it's somehow silenced or arrested or frozen or dead or something like that. Otherwise, it's not a thing, it's a living thing. So, but if we relate this to a kind of an activity that is generic at the same time, rather than I wouldn't say a dynamics, because dynamics always means it needs to be contained in a system. So in a framework which is given, and an activity, so this kind of activity which is unconditional. No? If you can relate the thing to this activity, which is an act, but on unconditional grounds. And to relate things to this somehow, but then it would be crucial not to name things. Because naming a thing is precisely what makes it a property. So naming a thing says what it is, it qualifies it, it turns the meteor into a star, let's say. and then if things were in relation to living space, it would be all about keeping things from being turned to stars. Yeah. But of course, then that's the question. How can one do this? No, how can one hold on to them without naming them? And that would be this, the reality in which an optics of this manner would make sense. Because there is the question of why should one, such an optics is so unlikely, it's so complicated, it's so abstract, it's so, it doesn't feel, it's not sensible. Yeah. Why should one do it? And I'm inclined to say precisely for keeping things safe. In a way, yeah. So from keeping them in being endowed with a liveliness, with an activity of their own, with a kind of an autonomous activity that we don't know how to name, and that is important, because as soon as we know how to name, it's not an activity anymore. And then the question with the activities. They then would be, in my understanding, they would have to be categorical, so not so abstract activities, not concrete activities, not taking with or touching or something like that, not sensible directly, but abstract. So activities that have to do with relating to this aging or this duration through a kind of a tempering. Yeah. So because through tempering, it's a bit like domesticating animals. You build up a kind of a trust without producing an identification with it. And of course, that is the difficult thing, how to build up trust without installing a play of identification and recognition. So then these activities would be, I would describe them mainly two, actually. One would be to think about how we can invert cycles. So cycles would be dynamics, no? Things that come and go, and then you can have resonances, and you can abduct things from these resonances by making them manifest or solid or giving them a body as an artifact. But the crucial thing for such an optics then would be, rather than doing this, it would be to invert the cycles. So to say, if these are natural cycles that happen, what would neutralize this action? So to be a mechanic in this sense, so to relate as a mechanic, not as an architect, to these cycles primarily. And then from being a mechanic like this, one can then become an architect by thinking about, because once you can invert the cycles, you can temper the action. So then you can temper the action, and tempering the action would be to scale this thing, this epiphany, to bring it to scales, and then they must be scales which are proportionate in a rational frame. So that means, because otherwise it can't be producing space, otherwise it would be a singular kind of experience. Yeah, so to invert cycles and to temper. And I think interestingly, when we look at quite recent architects that I was interested in my lecture course, we have a similar idea in Kengo Kuma, for example, who looks for the anti-object as a way to make architecture disappear. But what is difficult to grasp is that it is the making architecture disappear that is the architect's craft. Yeah? So this is like, I mean, it's very complicated to learn how to be present but not obtrusive. And it has something to do with this counterweight to gravity. It has something to do with gracefulness, with a kind of an unconditionality, which doesn't want to be reasonable necessarily. It wants to be well-tempered. And through being well-tempered, it can deal with many scales that are not commensurate with one another. So yeah, he would be somebody, but also, you know, Ishigami with the big question of another scale for architecture. It's going perhaps more than to a new kind of architecture after this kind of neutralization. Or Gilles Clément, of course, with the planetary gardening. So there are many, or even now, I this is quite recent, I found this new book by Lars Spuybroek, which will be coming out, I think, next week or so, or even this week. It's called Grace and Gravity. but I don't think he's making, as at least in the preface is already published on Academia, and he doesn't make any reference to Simone Weil in it, which I find a bit outrageous, but okay. So she's being abducted, it's fine. Can only be beautiful what comes out of it. But he has a similar idea. So he is obsessed with saying, I want to do a phenomenotechnique. No, phenotechnology, he calls it, for which the phenomenon itself is not a phenomenon for somebody who perceives it. So it's not an idealism, but it's a phenomenon which shines forth in itself. So it's a radiant phenomenon. And he thinks in terms of radiation, of course, and of the precisely of what we were talking about as well, of this material quality of light that we have with quantum physics and with computation too. Yeah, so I think I would expect that in the next 10 years there will be a lot of proposals to give words to these relations, or to relations similarly abstract, to make them better graspable. Yeah, so I think it's very exciting, and I think it's the start. So these ideas, by taking a quantum physics in such a literal sense, that means also a manifest sense, so in a new materialism kind of way, it really begins to make real what computation and architecture always had to do with each other. It would be to complement it with how to die. Necessarily. How to die, or to ask the question how to live in such an ekphrastic, not putting it into the basket, taking it along, but not attending to it, but rather, and then it's also very practical if you start to think about how, I mean, if there is this aging which is material both to spiritedness, to understanding, to insights, as well as to materiality, there is in every moment where there is life, there is death. Yeah. And I think space, if space really is what is abducted from time, space is death. It's related to death. And that's why space can be in favor of life, because it gives a complement to it. Yeah, that would be my question. How to die is, how to live and how to, let's be more cautious, how to relate to death while asking how to live or something like that.